Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending on where around the globe you are. Today's session is a coaching demo, Coaching Artistically to Unleash Client Greatness with Jean Francois Cousin. And so, first of all, we've got Mansoor in from Saudi Arabia, Tommaso from Italy, Joel is here from San Diego, Natalie is later in the evening in Australia, Brian from Cleveland. Mary from Evans, Georgia. Now, let me introduce the speaker for today, Jean Francois Cousin. Jean Francois is a sought-after keynote speaker. He's recognized for empowering inspiration and practical tips he offers during his sessions. A global executive and team coach, he served over 1,700 leaders and dozens of executive teams, visiting 35 countries on 6 continents to partner with them. He passionately helps the coaching profession grow and contribute more humanity, and served as chairman of the ICF Global Board in 2019. He also mentors coaches seeking to enrich their mastery. Now, for a fun fact, as of this week, Jean-Francois' coaching career is officially an adult. He's reached 18 years and 18,000 hours of coaching. And with that, Jean-Francois, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much, my good friend David. Thank you to all of you for joining from 6 continents today. And I do hope that our demo today and the whole experience of the session will help you find additional ways to unleash greatness in your clients and yourself, embody inspiration by adopting artistic touches. We're going to have a lot of fun as always, but just before, I'd love to have a few serious words about why this all matters. In fact, and perhaps some of you were at my previous session in June, right, where I made the case for an update of our coach's job description to make it fit for sustainability in an unsafe, complex, and disrupted world, and also to enable clients to reinvent a part of how they are and how they do things in that new world, and also to expand our profession beyond the reach of generative artificial intelligence. And I say that the ICF coaching definition on the left here could be further strengthened, I believe, with the idea that the creative process must not only inspire clients, but enable them to new thing, restore their well-being, sustain it, their stamina and their mindfulness as well, right? And also empower clients to generate new ways of thinking and of being, and those new ways they need to thrive across disruption. And I also advocated for reinforcing the language about the process of coaching that must unlock untapped or numbed sources of reinvention and leadership. And if we go with that enhanced definition, then what happens is for us coach, we need to awaken in our clients breadth and depths of new perspectives, and also the energy and the wisdom of their emotions and gut feelings for forward movement in that world we are in, right? Disruptive creativity and originality. And that is to say, really, we've got to awaken their inner artist, in fact, right? And of course, it comes to mind that perhaps we can do that by ourselves incorporating artistic touches in our core competencies. So what's the game today? The game plan is first to play at distinguishes what differences, what separates mastery to artistry in coaching, and the added value of artistry in our sessions. And then enjoy a demo and looking along the demo at what unleashes greatness in my client, Natalia. And after the demo, then we'll be kind of on a treasure hunt. The quest will be to discover 7 ways to unleash greatness and embody inspiration ourselves as coaches. So let's go for the first game. And that's about the differences between mastery and artistry. I would love that you share what comes to your mind as I show you a few pictures and you share your insights in the Q&A box. So as we look at differences between mastery and artistry, I'll show you a few drawings, portraits actually, from a painter. Yeah, and the game will be as the portraits he does evolve over his career and artistry unfolds, starting from mastery, to write in the chat, in the Q&A box, what the added value of artistry is according to you. So we start with a painting dated 1896 of an altar boy. That is absolutely not artistry. That is a copy of a Dutch master from the 17th century or 16th century, in fact, right? So this is mastery. It's just a copy paste. Now, a few years later, the same artist does this portrait of his mother. And then a few years later, of his sister. And the game is to track when artistry happens. For now, you probably imagine you're seeing kind of an impressionist painting here, right? Then the same artist paints himself for the first time, and the following paintings will be also self-portraits. And then a few years later again, that's his self-portrait. And then a few years later, that's another self-portrait. And then a few years later, that's another self-portrait. Has artistry started to flow in here or not yet, according to you? And then a year later, that's his self-portrait. And then, well, 10 years later, right? His self-portrait. And then a few years later, his self-portrait. And then many years later, his self-portrait. And then quite a few years later, his self-portrait. And then his last, very last self-portrait. Oh no, that is the last one, just a few weeks after the previous one. That's the last one, right? At 90 years of age. And the artist is Picasso. That was him. What are your insights about the added value of artistry inspired by this succession of different paintings? David, have you spotted anything coming up yet in our Q&A box today?
Well, it's interesting. We had Natalie said when he started the self-portraits, right? Armedu said, artistry emerges as he begins to explore himself, right? Less rigid, more emotion, more evocative. Exploring his craft after mastering his technique, being more creative and pushing the boundaries of his craft. I love that, pushing the boundaries of his craft.
Oh my God.
Perspectives unfolded, experimenting, better flow. Freedom to play with the form and add new value points and view and perspective.
Oh, what a series of gifts here. Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you, David. So I attempted to kind of put in a slide that perhaps you'd like to take a photo of for later. So some elements about mastery, artistry, and the added value of artistry in coaching, right? So when we think of mastery, what comes to mind can be the adherence to competencies and technical proficiency, obviously, skilled execution, as well as reproducibility. And when we think of artistry, right, then there's something about originality and innovation that needs to be said, right? And emotional impact, distinctive inspiration. You could see Picasso probably after 30 years of his self-portraits, right? Risk-taking, personal connection and resonance with the coaches in a world. And kind of an ability to navigate complexity with intuition. And when it comes to the added value of artistry in coaching, my humble experience, right? I think artistry unlocks different perspectives and emotions. Creative thinking, an inspired way of being, untapped or numbed sources of reinvention, and bold dialogue with the deeper self, as I think Natalie hinted, right? and with those in mind, the time has come to experiment with a coaching demo. And as we go through this demo, I'd love that you all try and notice what, if anything, unleashes Natalia's greatness, and that you share that in the chat box. And I am very, very delighted to welcome Miss Natalia Mamakina today to our session. Thank you so much, Natalia, for accepting to be my coach today. Natalia is Ukrainian and she is a national sales director for an American company since 2004. And she's now working remotely because her husband and her had to relocate from Ukraine to France when the war started in Ukraine in early 2022. As a leader, Natalia greatly values the development of her people, and she employs some coaching skills to accelerate their growth since 2004. Prior to the war in Ukraine, Natalia has traveled extensively across Asia, learning different meditation techniques along her journey. And now she continues her studies in psychology in a French university. Natalia loves incorporating Eastern holistic approaches and Western analytical techniques to personal growth. Natalia, thank you so very much again for joining us today from France. And before we start, Natalia, is there anything you need to be fully present to our conversation?
Thank you very much for being with me aujourd'hui. Today, I speak a little bit French and English at the same time. I will drink a little bit. And I'm with you completely.
Thank you very much, Natalia. So I am curious, what would you like to explore today?
What is really important for me now, as we relocated in France, here I am in absolutely different circumstances, in different society, in different culture. And how I feel, I lost my identity. I don't feel really who I am here. And so I am like changing all the time, my different hats. I am partly in Ukraine, partly in France. And so I'm lost. I'm lost a little bit, and I really want to find who I am now in this situation.
Yeah. So really find who you are in this situation. And how would you like that we dive into this exploration, Natalia?
Deeply? with pleasure.
With pleasure.
Yes. Yes, with pleasure.
Yeah. Where is the pleasure?
Where is the pleasure? Pleasure when I step a little bit in something unknown. But at the same time, I feel myself safe on the ground, but I could experiment. For me, this is a pleasure. It's like I'm touching with my foot, I'm touching cold water, but I know that it could be very refreshing, and it could give me a really boost. I'm not sure that is English. This is English word. This is boost of energy, and this is the pleasure. But I know that I could feel the ground. This is the pleasure.
Yeah. You know, Natalia, I noticed when you talked about cold water that you do touch with your feet, right? And then you get a boost of energy. I could see that, right? Your body started to vibrate. Yeah. So could we experiment, yeah, that you get that vibration? You imagine you touch a water with your foot, right? And then you get that kind of energy, right? And then you tell me about finding who I am in this situation. Can we try this?
Yes. Oh, I know. I know. I'm like sump that goes through water, and in this darkness, I see something interesting and something unexpected. And this is how I feel, who I am in this situation.
Yeah, not that.
Sun in deepness. Wait.
Yeah, could you simplify that for me, please, Natalia?
Yes. Something is getting easier. Something is getting more clear. And so the next step, I see the next step, what is going to happen. And it is not something dangerous. It is not something unexpected. It is something that invites me.
And that invitation, if you would put words on it, starting with Natalia, I invite you to what how would that go?
Natalia, I invite you to communicate, to share your opinion, to be louder, to speak, to share your ideas. So this is invitation to be more open to this new world.
Yeah, Natalia. And now, can we do the same game? But this time, it's not your head that answers; it's your heart, right? So, what would your heart? How would your heart speak about that invitation, Natalia.
Oh, I feel like a child that was invited to play a game with the other children, and I feel that that I am safe in this circle, and so I could be myself, and I could take risk. Yes.
Yeah, and then if we do two games at the same time, right, Natalia? Right. So still the invitation, but at the same time you put your foot in the cold water, you get that energy, right? And then it's the guts, right? The guts is where our energy is. That says what the invitation is, right? Would you like to play that? Activating
yes,
your
yes, 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 yes. It is really interesting. Interesting. I feel like I'm not just playing myself. I am playing with the other, and we are playing together, and we are creating something together. So it is something different, because. At the beginning, I was like invited, and now I'm creating with the others, and so it is absolutely different. So creating with the others. And it is very joyful.
Joy is coming back. Sorry.
And it is really pleasure. So we come back to pleasure.
Interesting, right? Come back to pleasure with a different energy. So tell me about your energy now, Natalia.
I feel that energy changed, because at the beginning it was just something mental in my head, but now it is a like it appears a belief that this is the reality, and my mental image now, it has energy and it has life. It has life now. It's like alive now.
Yeah. And it's interesting. Can I share an observation, Natalia? At mm-hmm. the beginning, you were mental, and to me, you were metal. Your voice sounded like metallic, nah? Mm-hmm. And then with that journey, you just did, right? It's like, yeah, the flesh and the joy came up, right? Do you remember at which point of your sharing of your experience, Natalia, did you have like the energy you enjoyed the most? In what of what you shared with me, at what moment your energy?
I think it was the moment when I touched the water and I see something with the light. With the light, so it was like I see more than I see now. Because what I think that mentally I could just imagine myself something, and but with the energy that appears, so I like trust myself.
Natalia, okay, you trust yourself. You had this pleasure of creating with others, right? And I'm curious, what in the background could perhaps drag you away or hold you back, you know, in the dark side, perhaps somewhere behind you, if anything?
All my achievements in the past, they are very significant, and of course I don't want to leave them. This is my treasure, and this is my treasure, but this is like something that that keeps me from the present moment, from the life that I'm choosing now. And for me, this is really painful because I could not leave my past. And maybe I don't want to leave. I don't know.
Yeah.
But this is something that really don't give me to feel pleasure and to feel this this light.
There was some emotion, yeah, just now, right? I sensed, perhaps wrongly, Natalia, if there was emotion when you shared that, my question is, what does that emotion want for you?
This this emotion that they want me to pray and to believe that everything is what is happening is better for me.
What more?
More. I know what to do with this. Because I was already in a really serious situation in my life, so and what I know, yes, I know when I looked back in the situation that was very very all the situations. They were very, very painful for me. And after, when I looked at this situation, I realized that it was turning point. it was really really the beginning of something significant and really, really important for me.
Oh.
Turning point.
Can we be very ambitious here and try to connect the two sides? Yeah, the sides of the loss, the pain, right? And the sides of the pleasure and the gain, right? And that creating with others and expressing your ideas loud.
That is something that I always forget, that all this energy, it doesn't have color, positive or negative. It is just energy. And this is my mind who is coloring the energy. But of course, when it is painful or something, and I feel, I think that it is painful, it seems that it is not energy, it is not pure energy, it is, it seems something dark. But it is always just energy that changes changes potential. Depending on how I perceive it, of my perception. So it could be something that is really, really very heavy for me, or it could be something that that really gives me up, gives me wings. And what I think really that it is not. It is just my choice. To choose. It is going to be something that gives me the energy or gives me the darkness. But I don't always want to take this responsibility. And this is the truth. Because with this responsibility, it is a lot of obligations, a lot of work, a lot of pleasure. And a lot of life. Sorry.
Thank you so much for sharing so deeply, you know, Natalia. I am curious now, where are you with the question, who I am in this situation?
Oh, where I am with this question? I think it is not bad already. I think it is Me who really decides who I am.
Yeah. And now you're very zen. Zen, like I know you like Asian philosophies and as we need to wrap up now already, Natalia, what is perhaps something precious that you're going to keep with you from our very short conversation today?
I'm going to take this image of darkness and light at the same time. It is this symbol, black and white, at the same time. So I think I need to have this symbol with me. Just to remember that it is always exist those two sides in all situation, and this is only me who choose what side is going to be with me now.
And now, if I may share an observation, Natalia, I think your skin is like so purer. Does it make any sense?
Oh, it's I'm like newborn, something. A little bit.
A little
Like
bit.
newborn.
Yeah, new. Oh, yeah, exactly. Newborn, absolutely. My, thank you so very much, Natalia. We could go on so much deeper, so much longer. Of course, we've got the
Thank
clock
you.
ticking, Natalia. I'm so grateful. Please stay with us, right? And perhaps, David, we go to you for just a minute to harvest what our friends around the world have perhaps shared in the Q&A along this conversation with Natalia. Natalia, thank you so very much again. David.
Thank you.
We have questions. We also have the participants' feedback on what unleashes the client's greatness. Where would you like me to start?
We'll take the question at the end, and perhaps we'll take right away their observations about what unleashes greatness that came to their mind, right?
Patrick came, brought up that the client's self-talk came from both the head and the heart. Now, part of that was your invitation and giving Natalia the chance to play with both somatic and cerebral really facilitated that greatness. Your invitation was the key to exploration that led to creating with others. This is Mary, and she said it brought the joy and the pleasure and life. Brilliant. Right. Natalie felt like when the water and the walking with the heart had started to unleash Natalia's perspective shift and the idea started to flow. She said, such courage. Patrick said, energy with intuitive perception from the heart and not just from and not from the head. And Gerilou said, recognize the power of choice is gifting the client control of self.
Yeah, beautifully said, right? Oh my, thanks very much, David. Thanks very much, everyone. In the next section of our conversation today, I'd love to come back to the treasure hunt, and this time the quest is to find out together 7 ways for you to unleash greatness in your clients and to embody inspiration. Right. So I'm going to play a few things to just trigger perhaps your imagination about what those 7 ways I'm offering are about. And the first game, in a way, is a game of silence, really. So I'll just let you read now. And just before we go through the quest, we can have hope, because our beloved Picasso said every child is an artist. The problem is how to remain an artist once we grow up. And obviously he found some solutions, right? We can too. All right. So again, I'll be silent for a moment to let you read this. And the first way that can help us be inspiration and help clients or enable clients to unleash greatness in themselves, I think, is to be still at times and invite kind of a contemplative silence to the conversation for inspiration's sake. And I hope that at times you could see I was deliberate in being silent for quite some time with Natalia. Silence is our best partner in coaching, in addition to the client's energy, right? So, something else for your consideration. And this is that the bigger the sizes of your world and your dreams, the more you will inspire others to dream big. So to expand the size of our inner world, of our dreams as well, right? It's really important that we heed the advice of Steve Jobs, which is like, it's people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world that do, right? And so the invitation here is embrace the unknown, as Natalia mentioned, by the way, right? Explore unfamiliar places or communities and include mavericks in your inner circle. And that will help, as well as expand the size of your inner world by discovering through metaphors the inner world of the client. We didn't have enough time today with Natalia to work on the metaphors that she offered, right? But there were plenty. And in an hour-long conversation, of course, we would have enriched the exploration by penetrating deeper into the inner world of Natalia, right? And so here, another way to be inspiration and to enable greatness to come out from the client, right, is to expand the size of our inner world. Something more that we can do is suggested by this drawing from Salvador Dali, and it is that intelligence without ambition is like a bird without wings. And very interestingly, actually, when I said to Natalia, shall we be ambitious and connect the dark and the pleasure, right? Shortly after, actually, Natalia mentioned about a bird with wings, right? And that was being very ambitious, embracing a very difficult thing to do, which Natalia brilliantly did. And thank you, Natalia, again, right? So the way is raise our ambition level for what great is, and raise our ambition level for the work at hand in coaching sessions, right? In partnership with our clients, of course. Yeah? Now, the fourth way of being inspiration, I'd love that you guess what I have in mind as I tell you a story. And that is a story about Kafka. As you know, right? The famous author from the previous century, right? So at 40 years of age, a story goes that Franz Kafka, who had no children, was walking in a park in Berlin when he met a little girl who was crying because she had lost a doll. She and Kafka searched for the doll without success. Kafka offered to come back the next day to look for the doll again with the little girl, and he did. They still did not find the little girl. The doll was nowhere to be found. Back home, Kafka had an idea. And the next day, he gave the little girl a letter written by the doll that said, "Don't cry. I went on a trip to see the world. I will write about my adventures to you." And whenever Kafka and the little girl met, Kafka read the doll's latest letter containing her adventures and conversations. And the child, the little girl, found them adorable. And then one day, Kafka said to the girl, "The doll is back in Berlin." And then he gave the girl to the doll, to the little girl. But then the little girl said, "She doesn't look like my doll at all." And then Kafka handed another letter in which the doll had written, "My travels have changed me." So the little girl kissed the new doll and carried her home very happy. A year later, Kafka died. A few years later, the little girl had become an adult, and she found the doll, and inside the doll, she found a letter signed by Kafka, which said, "All that you love will probably be lost, but in the end, love will return in another way." That is the well-known story, of course, of the omnipresence of loss, and it's called Kafka and the Traveling Doll. You can find it on Google very easily. And I wanted to offer this story as a conduit to this fourth way of being inspiration and helping clients unleash greatness, challenge clients to free themselves from old stories and invent a better future. Okay. And to bring up the fifth way, I'm going to show you Lady Gaga for just a few seconds again, as I did in June, but saying something else.
The greatest piece of advice I've ever received. It is, if you don't have any shadows, you're not standing in the light. The greatest piece of advice I've ever received. It is, if you don't have any shadows, you're not standing in the light.
And that is why I invited Natalia after a first part of our conversation on the pleasure side, right, to explore the other side, because light and shadows, they live inside of us. And by shadows, I mean our secret lives, the one we don't let others know about, the dark side of our personality, the fears, the traumas, the disappointments, also the inherited instincts, when we often can find or hide violence and rage and hate, right? And it's also dreams that never come true, came true, right? And the more we repress the shadow, the more destructive it becomes, right? So here, the idea, of course, is that we discover the shadows, right? We understand what they want. At some point, you heard me ask Natalia, what does that emotion want for you, right? And use the power of the shadow to transform, to help the client transform for greatness sake, right? A first step in that work is to decide that we will love our client's pain, yeah? And so the fifth approach to perhaps coaching artistically, right? And catalyze far more inspiration and body inspiration is connect and partner with our client's shadows and use them as created resources, right? The sixth way is a gift from Vincent van Gogh, who said the great artist is the simplifier. Perhaps you remember at one moment I invited Natalia to simplify, which is of course so very difficult and calls for the coachee to go deep, and it's really an act of the ultimate sophistication, as Leonardo da Vinci said, right? So the sixth way is to invite our clients to simplify their ideas to the essence. I saw the session was 90 minutes, so I packed a bit too much stuff, and I'm gonna, but you'll have the full deck anyway, right? There was this idea of inviting you to listen to some music and listen to your guts and hearts and watch a few works of art and find out how you will embody inspiration. And then what I'm going to do is to invite you to do this perhaps for just 1 minute, right? I'll play just a minute of music, and feel free to share in the Q&A as we go to a real Q&A together, how you will embody inspiration. Perhaps I will play one more time this slide where I've put together the seven ways to coach artistically and catalyze far more inspiration and ultimately embody inspiration. So you can take a screenshot if you'd like, yeah, and keep those with you, all right? And then we're going to have the ultimate pleasure, which is a conversation, right? David, are you ready? I'd love that Natalia and I can have the conversation with you and everyone now, yeah?
And before to the Q&A, quick reminder for our participants. After you leave the webinar, the survey is going to pop up on your screen. So please take a few seconds to fill it in, because your feedback is incredibly valuable to help us continue developing the services that we provide to you. All right, so let's grab a couple of quick questions. So Sabrina had asked, What's the inner work that you do to be so present and available to the artistry?
Thanks, Sabrina, for the question. Right, for me, coaching is an act of unconditional love for the inner greatness of clients. Right, you heard me say that many times in many webinars, I guess, unconditional love. Right, and so what I do is only nourish my unconditional love for others and for the world. Right, so that means gratitude. That means some contemplation. That means taking time to appreciate beautiful things, see the beauty in people, right? That nourishes me. When my client comes on video or in my office, I see so much beauty inside, right? Thanks, Sabrina, for the question.
Natalia, we have a question for you. Cuxhall saw that you were taking notes during the session. He's curious, what did you get from the session first, according to you, and also based on the notes you took?
I took for myself several images that will be symbolic for me to keep all my conclusions alive for me.
Beautiful, thank you. One more question. Vinod had asked that Natalia is doing some really deep digging here, and he felt like some of the emotions that she's tapping into were dark energy. One of the things he noticed, or at least he felt at that point during the coaching demo, Jean Francois, was it doesn't seem to be acknowledged by the coach. So I think he's curious about how you chose to go with the darker energy or not go with the darker energy.
Okay, so I chose to go to the dark energy, right? I was the one who brought out, let's go to the dark side, basically, right? What can hold you back from the past, perhaps, or what's behind that could drag you back, right? So I did that, right? I brought that because yin and yang, right? We had the first part that was quite sunny, right? We need the obscurity as well to harvest it, right? And then, if you don't remember, we have 60 minutes. I thought it was 90. So I had to do with Natalia a work in 20 minutes, right? My standard time for coaching session is 60 minutes, right? So of course, I have many, many choices to make about what to go with, what not to go with, based on how much time we can play. Yeah?
Okay, and by the way, that was a question from Dennis. I had messed up the
Dennis. Okay. No.
Geez, so often, how can this word be leveraged in any exploration?
Again, David?
Vinod was asking that Natalia's using the word energy so often. How can you leverage that word in any exploration? Not just with Natalia, but in general.
Yeah, Vinod, energy is the most precious in a client, right? In ourselves, that makes us survive, right? But it's most precious in client because energy never lies, right? That's why I always recommend, and you've seen me probably in other demos, go to the energy, right? We always start from the head and the heart and the guts, right? Go to the energy because that is where we will have the most precious information. It's very rare, very, very rare that I would have a session where I would not invite the energy of the client to speak to the in the conversation. Thanks for the question, Vinod. Great.
Beautiful. Jean-Francois, thank you.